tonight, inside the North Korea the regime wants to keep hidden.
The way North Korean regime keeps the regime going is this pervasive security apparatus and fear tactics.
If people stop believing in the regime, that means central control is breaking down.
With undercover footage and exclusive interviews, Frontline uncovers a new generation risking their lives to smuggle images out and information in.
North Korean defectors have emerged as very quiet agents of social progress.
Threatening Kim Jong-un's total control of what the world sees of North Korea and of what North Koreans see of the world.
There really is a potential here that something quite dramatic could happen.
But how far will the new dictator go to hold on to power?
If a government is willing to kill as many people as necessary to stay in power, it usually stays in power for a very long time.
Tonight, Frontline takes you inside the secret state of North Korea.
Oh, 그래. 도착했어. 어디 들었어? 그렇군요.
Jiro Ishimaru is a journalist trying to expose what Kim Jong-un's regime wants to hide, the secret world of the North Korean people. He has an undercover network which covertly films life inside the country.
그럼
Obviously, it's an extremely dangerous thing to do. In North Korea, even filming everyday life is considered a form of political treason. If they're caught filming, they'd be locked up and may never be let out again.
Even filming on the Chinese side of the border is illegal.
もう止まんこ高さ高いね去年1年前なかったんですよもう脱北者を出さないんだっていう中国政府のやっぱり強い意志それと心理的な圧力を北朝鮮側の住民にかけているんだというふうに思います
The people who work for Jiro smuggle their footage across the Tumen River, which divides China from North Korea. The North Korean border guards have been known to shoot to kill. The border has become even more tightly controlled since Kim Jong-un took over as supreme leader 2 years ago, the third ruler in the Kim dynasty after his father and grandfather. He inherited the world's most isolated country, where the people have no internet, and the state has almost total control on any information coming in or out. Even with the tight security, Jiro and his Japanese news organization managed to get the footage out. He's going to meet one of his contacts, who's made it across the border with new images from North Korea. They secretly film in areas no foreigners or journalists are allowed to visit. These are pictures Kim Jong-un doesn't want the world to see. Jiro has recruited a network of ordinary North Koreans living in towns across the country. They risk their lives to get the footage. One of his contacts is a state employee, but has been smuggling footage out for 5 years. He agreed to speak if his identity was concealed.
This is dangerous, and if I get caught, I know I'd immediately be executed as a traitor to the Korean people. But I've got to do this. I've got to do this no matter what. I'm just one person. Even if I have to sacrifice my life, someday something is going to change.
The famine, which killed more than a million North Koreans in the 1990s, has ended. But the United Nations says the country is still vulnerable to food shortages, and more than three quarters of the population don't have enough food to eat. Over the past 3 years, Jiro's undercover network has filmed orphaned street kids gathering in the markets, begging for money, and on the lookout for scraps of food. For the safety of the people filming, he disguises their voices. Very few of these orphan children managed to escape North Korea. But we found one who did. He asked to be identified as Lee and agreed to speak to us if we concealed his true identity.
My father passed away when I was three. And then my mother left home and didn't return. I was very hungry. I was almost always hungry when I was young. There were times when I ate a meal a day. But when I starved, I didn't eat for 2 days. Because I was hungry, I stole and picked pockets. I lived like that until I was 14 years old. There were many others. And there were children who starved to death.
Did any of your friends die?
Yes, they did.
How old were you all then?
I was about 11.
Undercover footage from last March shows a group of homeless orphans trying to stay warm in below zero temperatures. There is an elite in the capital city, Pyongyang. And despite tough international sanctions, they live a comfortable life with the latest luxury goods. This woman was filmed getting into a newly imported Mercedes on her wedding day. North Korean state TV makes the country out to be a land of plenty. They show pictures of an advanced economy, happy, well-fed children, and shops overflowing with goods. Pyongyang's department store number one is stocked with imported products from around the world. But as Jiro's footage shows, many of the items are not for sale. The department store is regularly featured on state TV, which tells its people they live in the best country on earth. One of the regime's senior propagandists defected and is now living in the South.
물리적 독재, 이것과 함께 감성 독재로 주민들을 억압하게.
As well as a physical dictatorship, they oppress people with an emotional dictatorship. In North Korea, they promote the leader to be the sun. If you go too close, you burn. If you go too far, you freeze to death. You think of him as incredibly godlike. We thought he didn't even go.
North Koreans can't escape the omnipresent propaganda. Kim Jong-un's speeches are pumped from speakers on street corners. This one was on a loop for 3 months, promising his people a bright economic future. Since the North and the South split in the late 1940s, hatred of America has been central to North Korean indoctrination. This government video shows a North Korean dreaming of New York City being destroyed by a missile attack.
The average North Korean believes a significant part of the anti-American propaganda. They believe that Americans are ready to invade. They believe that America is a threat. They believe that Americans started the Korean War in order to enslave or maybe commit a large-scale genocide in Korea. They believe it. Not all, but majority.
In Pyongyang, state TV news is broadcast on public squares, warning of imminent war with America. Once a week, whole villages are required to attend meetings glorifying the leader. The regime demands displays of total loyalty. If you don't attend these weekly meetings, you could come under suspicion.
The way North Korean regime keeps the regime going, one of the reasons is fear tactics.
In Korea, it's not only the person who commits the crime that is punished. Often, their whole family will be arrested for guilt by association.
It's up to three generations. When the senior most North Korean defector, Hwang Jang-yeop, defected, his relatives were rounded up in North Korea and were sent to prison camps. These guys didn't even know they were related to Hwang Jang-yeop when the security guys came knocking on their door. They said, well, I'm related to Hwang? He was like a ninth cousin. This is how North Korea operates.
Recent satellite imagery analyzed by Amnesty International shows that since Kim Jong-un came to power, the political prison camps have grown.
200,000 civilians that are outside of the criminal penal system. One of the camps, Hwasong, is 540 square kilometers. It's three times the size of Washington, D.C.
It's estimated that as many as 1 in 100 North Koreans is a political prisoner, many of whom were caught trying to defect. Still, several thousand North Koreans try to escape through China each year. Lee, the former street kid, fled when he was 18.
I was
very scared, but I thought, It's better to die than live like an insect. Before I left, I prepared a little bit of food. I roasted some beans. I ate little bits of that as I went on my way. I went to the top of the mountains to see where the guards were positioned. Then at night, I crossed the river when nobody was watching. I crossed the river alone and made it into China. I used the sun to get my directions and went inland.
Defectors like Lee risk getting caught and sent back by China, North Korea's closest ally. But Lee says he met a broker who smuggled him 2,000 miles to the South Korean embassy in Thailand. He was granted asylum and flew to Seoul, where he has lived for the last 2 years. He still hides his identity because he's afraid of North Korean agents discovering him.
I graduated from high school in February this year. I'm currently looking for a job, but I'm not working yet. Although I live in South Korea now, it still troubles me to think about the North Korean children who suffer out there like I used to.
North Korea is a society that has fallen ill. It's a diseased society that needs to be cured. Our footage is forcing North Korea to acknowledge the hardship that their people face. The authorities don't like it at all. Because if the truth gets out, it would put Kim Jong-un's power under threat.
Jiro Ishimaro smuggles footage out of the country, but there is also a steady flow of information back in. Jung Kwang-il is a defector living in Seoul who smuggles foreign films and TV shows into North Korea.
The men prefer watching action films. Men love their action films. I sent them Skyfall recently. The women enjoy watching soap operas and dramas. They like that kind of film. Now they're sharing thumb drives a lot. Even officials have one or two thumb drives. North Korea is trying to hunt them down because the thing that changes people's mindsets is popular culture. It probably has the most important role in bringing about democracy in North Korea.
Jung and his partner, also a defector, are on their way to the Chinese border to smuggle in laptops, radios, thumb drives, and DVDs.
Of course, there's a risk. But I want to send them in, so I just do it. In North Korea, rumor has it there are 100 people that are desperate to get their hands on me. But they don't know when I go, do they?
They are filming their trip with a hidden camera. Posing as mushroom importers, they bribed a border guard to let them across. The border guard isn't where he said he'd be, so they call him.
Hey, get that. 못한다니까. 그런 사람 땡겨? 그런 사람 땡기냐고. 저도 지금 거기 새끼를 내다본다.
내다본다고요?
사람 안뜰안뜰한 게 보이지?
저 새끼들은 무슨 일?
The guard says he can't get them across, so they decide to wait until night. Before defecting, Chung used to cross the border illegally as a smuggler until he was caught and accused of being a spy. He was taken to a notorious political prison camp, Yodok.
When I arrived at the prison camp, it was April 6th, 2000. It was awful when I went inside. That day they completely beat the hell out of me. They'd put a wooden stick behind your knees and make you sit down, like this. If they pushed down on you, you'd collapse and then you'd hear your kneecaps cracking. I got beaten up and tortured for about 9 months. Before I got arrested, I weighed 165 pounds.
75 kilo 정도 나갔는데 10개월이 지난 다음 그
After 10 months, I had a physical.
지금 사는데 그때 몸무게
When I looked at what I weighed, I was 79 pounds.
36kg.
I couldn't endure it anymore.
더는 버티지 못하겠더라고.
After 3 years in Yodok, he says the authorities determined he wasn't a spy and let him out. A year later, he defected and has been working against the regime ever since. Tonight, he's going back to the border. Chung waits on the Chinese side of the Tumen River for his North Korean smuggler. They find each other by sparking their cigarette lighters. DVDs and thumb drives make their way to markets across the country that are filled with goods illegally smuggled from China. Some of his thumb drives and DVDs to two teenage girls and films them watching. It's been reported that almost half of the North Koreans who defect had watched foreign television, even though it's illegal.
Information and knowledge of the outside world is beginning to widen out. There's far more interpenetration of North Korean society today than before. If North Korean people themselves stop believing in the regime and the story they tell themselves, that means central control is breaking down in some ways.
Kim Jong-un has reportedly been sending his security forces house to house, searching for illegal DVDs. And last November, ordered the execution of as many as 80 people, some for watching foreign television.
시간에는 북한의 김정은 제1비서의 부인인 리설주가 음란물을 촬영했다는 소문이 퍼지면서 북한 당국이 이 소문의 최초 유포자를 색출하고 있다는 소식을 전해드렸는데요. 오늘은 리설주
Open Radio for North Korea is a station staffed by defectors transmitting stories into the country from across the border in the south.
What the North Korean regime fears the most is information about the outside world going into the country. We tell the North Korean people how vicious their dictatorship is. If someone listens to these broadcasts and passes the story on to other people, and if the story is political, it becomes a very serious matter. In these cases, I understand that some even face public execution.
The story they are broadcasting today, that Kim Jong-un's wife, a former pop star, recorded a pornographic video, is quickly spreading around North Korea and has provoked a vicious reaction. The station reports that the singer of the popular song Horse Lady and other performers in this video have been executed for starting the rumor.
Because North Koreans are so cut off, they're incredibly curious. And we found that people take the risk of listening to these broadcasts.
Surveys of defectors suggest that more than 1 million North Koreans listen to illegal foreign radio.
The more I listened to the radio, the more I thought, what we've learned isn't true. I've been fooled. And it's made me want to become free.
Chen Yang is 22. She lives in Seoul, but grew up in a remote region of North Korea. Her father bought the family a radio, which he modified to pick up foreign stations.
My father was preparing to come here since I was 9 years old. Living constantly in fear like that was really difficult. If we got caught, the whole family would get taken away. I was exhausted by it all, so I asked my father, even if it's North Korea, can't we just live safely? But he said, no, I want your generation to learn freely.
When Chunhyang was 17, her family decided to defect. To avoid raising suspicion, they left at different times. She was the last to leave.
I was always being watched. The people watching weren't just from the government. The people who were watching me were my friends and neighbors. I knew all of this, but had to act as if I didn't.
After 2 years laying low, Chunhyang escaped through China and reunited with her family in Seoul.
My brother and sister had grown up so much when I saw them, and their accents had all changed too. But we were all back together again in a circle. We're a family of five. We were all just so happy that we didn't even need to say a word. The first thing we did was just eat together.
Chunhyang now appears on a weekly TV show with other defectors called On My Way to Meet You.
Here is my name and my phone.
It's broadcast in South Korea, but is a popular show smuggled back into the North.
My friends back home watch it, and all the children of the party officials in North Korea watch it and say they will defect. We're going to talk about that today. When my friends see me on the show, they'll fantasize about South Korea. They'll say I've changed a lot. In North Korea, I never smiled.
The show is part current affairs, part talent show. Part beauty pageant.
North Korean defectors have emerged as very quiet agents of social progress in North Korea because people often assume that they just leave North Korea and that's it. And at this point where you have over 20,000 North Korean refugees that resettled in South Korea, that's a significant population that are joining forces to reconnect with their families back inside. And when they see that one of them can leave that community, go to South Korea, that's a huge wake-up for them that shows just how much more advanced and how much more open South Korea is.
Chung is back in Seoul, meeting with a group of defectors who are plotting against the North Korean regime.
Oh, 힘들다. 이 계단 올라오는 것도 이렇게 막 힘들면 어떻게 죽을 때 다 된 것 같아. 신발 벗어야 되죠.
영희 and her husband Jung Oh have found another way to penetrate Kim Jong Un's secret state.
달라 보내자. 그래가지고. 그냥 또
따라 보내기 시작해. 그 이거는 세계에서 다 움직일 수 있는 돈이거든요. 그 북한에도 예약 상점이라고 있는데 거기서도 이거를 그 뭐야 북한 돈으로 바꿔서 사용할 수 있어요. 내가
이 달러 1달러면 옥수수 같은 거 한 4kg
가족이 이틀을 먹고 산다고 하거든요. 뭐, 제품이라고.
네, 네.
그러니까 로또라고 보면 되죠. 북한에서
Like Chung. Young-hee says she suffered at the hands of the North Korean regime. Her brother was caught trying to defect, and she was punished. She says she was locked up and tortured by security agents.
한 거의 6일 동안 맞고 머리하고 다리를 많이 맞았는데 여기는 지금 이렇게 누르면 그 아기들 금방 났을 때 내가 말랑말랑하잖아요. 그런 것처럼 이게 지금 그렇게 되어 있어요. 그래가지고 너네 같은 가족이 살아남으면 안 된다.
She says the officers tied her brother's hands to the back of a truck and dragged him along a dirt road as an example to others.
얼굴이가 이게 끌려 잘 끌려가다 나니까 이게 온통 다 빗겨졌더라고요. 이 코부터 시작해서 몸에 딱지를 딱지 않아가지고 이게 막 그 피 딱지가 그냥 이렇게 있더라고요. 근데 저희 엄마가 제가 그걸 보는 순간에 말을 못했어요. 오빠한테 어떤 말을 어떻게 해야 될지. 저희 오빠는 한마디도 말 못하고 그냥 고개만 숙이고 있고. 그래서 그것이 제 오빠의 만남의 마지막이었거든요.
Young Hee escaped with her husband and son, leaving her brother and mother behind.
나쁜 거지 국민들은 나쁜 거 아니다. 저 정권이 빨리 바뀌었으면 좋겠어요.
아니 아니 판 빼세요. 여기 판 빼세요.
네 감 빼고.
감 빼서.
여기다.
자 이거를 막아.
손 손나.
이거를 막아.
그때면 하늘을 쳐다본대요. 예 하늘에서 돈이 떨어진다.
아 시작 수단 자유북한 자유북한.
For the first time, the mysterious and secretive nation. There is nothing imminent, but these threatening statements have everyone on edge. Are we on the brink of a nuclear war? Last spring, North Korea became the first country since the Cold War to threaten the United States mainland with a nuclear attack. When watching this, I thought, wow, even from North Korean standards, this is really over the top.
They always do this cycle of provocation. It's just the intensity of the recent provocation was even greater.
I don't think anybody really believed the North Koreans were going to launch a nuclear missile at the United States. But the basic question that rose, does this guy know where the red line is? Does he know when the bluster should stop? Or is he really going to do something stupid? This fellow may not know what is real and what is a video game.
Western intelligence agencies were concerned because they knew so little about the young leader.
It's really sad, but when Kim Jong-un first came known, the CIA had this one, that picture of 11-year-old boy with that bratty grin, and that's what we were working with. This is the photo that we had. And what we knew about it was already in the New York Times. It wasn't really much more than that.
Kim Jong-un was brought up by his mother, opera singer Ko Yung-hee, one of Kim Jong-il's four wives. He spent 3 years in a school in Switzerland, posing as the son of a diplomat. At the age of 18, he was called back to Pyongyang, where he was secretly groomed to become leader. State media had never shown Kim Jong-un or mentioned him by name until the year before his father's death in December 2011. He was then unveiled to the North Korean public in this state-produced documentary.
(laughs)
Kim Jong-un succeeded his father and grandfather to become the new leader of North Korea.
In North Korea, reverence for age, experience, these things matter. And now you're sort of parading around this 29-year-old guy who did not serve a day in the military. I doubt that people genuinely have that kind of feeling towards Kim Jong-un as they did for Kim Jong-il.
We would say, how can this boy who's still wet behind the ears be in power? But the North Korean government spread these rumors that although he was young, he was very wise. That's what the government kept saying.
Jiro's undercover footage shows people all over the country being forced to prove their dedication to the new leader, but some resenting having to do it. These soldiers were ordered to build a railroad from Kim Jong-un's birthplace to Pyongyang to mark him coming to power. The undercover footage even shows a local official criticizing Kim Jong-un's succession. To compensate for his lack of experience, the regime made parallels with his grandfather, Kim Il-sung, who is still widely worshipped and is officially eternal president of North Korea.
There's all kinds of rumors that Kim Jong-un even had cosmetic surgery to look like his grandfather. But certainly his style, it seems to be more like Kim Il-sung as well.
Trying to be a reincarnation of his grandfather, which is actually smart in a way because his grandfather is remembered by a lot of North Koreans as a much more benevolent leader than his father. It's PR style at the moment. According to the defectors that I've spoken with who've left the country fairly recently, the economy has not improved under Kim Jong-un.
The problem for Kim Jong-un is that North Koreans' expectations are changing.
Because more information is flowing in, it's getting very difficult to make people obey. There are very few people left who blindly obey every command that comes from on high.
Behind closed doors, even members of the North Korean elite have voiced unhappiness with the regime. Like this businesswoman filmed at a private lunch. The cynicism about their leaders comes partly from radical change in the way people make a living.
Looking at footage shot inside North Korea, we can see that a huge number of people have started doing business with each other. This used to be illegal, and anyone caught buying or selling for personal gain was severely punished.
Illegal markets first began to appear when the state became unable to feed its people during the famine. Today, the state tolerates them, but people are pushing the limits of private enterprise. This woman is running an illegal private bus service. An army officer tries to stop her from picking up passengers.
People's willingness to confront or ignore authority has become more and more common. People around the world have this image of North Koreans as being brainwashed, but that's very mistaken. Often now when North Koreans are challenged for infringing a certain law, as long as the offense is not political, they don't hesitate to protest if they believe the law to be irrational.
Until recently, it was illegal for women to wear pants. Soldiers are arguing with this woman about breaking the dress code. The soldiers put an armband on her to mark her offense. But before long, she rips it off, and a senior officer steps in. Cell phones arrived in North Korea. The undercover footage shows dozens of people lining up to buy SIM cards. The phones can only make calls inside North Korea, but they can be modified to call outside the country. A very serious crime.
There's an awareness and ability for the population to communicate instantaneously that was never there before. North Korea went from 0 to 1 million cell phone registrations in 3 years. But to get from 1 million to 2 million, and probably to get from 2 million to 3 million will only take 6 months. That concrete wall that has been there for 60 years or so will become more porous.
These changes cannot be stopped. Marketization, information flows, all of these kind of trends lead to a transformation one way or another of North Korea. The system as it stands is just unsustainable.
Kim Jong-un faces the dictator's dilemma, which is they need to open up to survive, but the process of opening up could lead to the collapse of the regime, not the state, but of the regime. And so this is a dilemma that he faces. It's one his father faced, it's one his grandfather faced.
This dilemma has led to a power struggle at the very top of the government, according to the regime's former propagandist.
In the past, there weren't hardliners and reformers. There was only party loyalty. Today, however, rival factions have formed. The fact a split exists shows he hasn't got a stable leadership like his father. So the only way for Kim Jong-un to hold on to power is through a reign of terror.
Kim Jong-un came to power surrounded by his father's generals. Since then, he has purged almost half of the top military. In December 2013, his uncle, Jang Song-taek, an advocate for reform, who'd served at the top of the government for 30 years, was forcibly removed from a party meeting. A week later, he was executed.
If a government is willing to kill as many people as necessary to stay in power, it usually stays in power for a very long time. There are many people who are not happy. there are many people who, in the privacy of their bedrooms, sometimes say something very, very subversive to their wives and most trusted friends. But no networks and no activities yet, because the government is brutal.
Even if, let's say, the public is more aware of the outside world, is that going to necessarily lead them to have a revolution? Several people cannot even get together to even talk about it. With what's happening in the Middle East, there's a Twitter, there's Facebook, there's people can get mobilized, they can get together. The way Korean system is set up right now, they don't have any kind of mechanism to do that.
I think in the case of North Korea, there are credible pieces that you can put together and say, there really is a potential here that something quite dramatic could happen. No one could predict the collapse of the Soviet Union. No one could predict the Arab Spring. Afterwards, everybody said it was obvious.
It's not easy to predict when the regime will fall. However, the foundations of change in North Korea are being laid. North Koreans have undergone a huge shift in their collective mindset. I think change will come.
いうふうに思ってます。